This lecture is all about apparent brightness, luminosity, and distance. We'll begin with apparent brightness and luminosity. If you go outside on any clear night, you'll immediately see that some stars are brighter than other stars. The difference in brightness does not by itself tell us anything about how much light these stars are generating, because the brightness of a star depends on its distance, as well as on how much light it actually emits. For example, the stars Procyon and Betelgeuse appear about equally bright in our sky, but Betelgeuse emits about 15,000 times as much light as Procyon. Procyon appears as bright because it's over 50 times closer. Because two similar-looking stars can be generating very different amounts of light, we need to distinguish clearly between a star's brightness in our sky and the actual amount of light that it emits into space. A star's apparent brightness is how it appears to our eyes. We define apparent brightness as the amount of power reaching us per unit area or per square meter. Luminosity is the total amount of power that a star emits into space. When we talk about how bright stars are in an absolute sense, regardless of their distance, we're talking about luminosity. For example, a 100-watt light bulb always puts out the same amount of light. Its luminosity doesn't vary, but its apparent brightness will depend on how far away you are from the bulb. The apparent brightness of a star or any light source obeys an inverse square law with distance, much like the inverse square law for the force of gravity. In equation form, the inverse square law of light says that the apparent brightness equals luminosity over 4 pi times the distance squared. Consider this figure. The same total amount of light must pass through each imaginary sphere surrounding the star. Pretend you're standing on the first sphere. You draw a square meter on its surface and you count the number of photons that pass through your square each second. Let's say you measure 4 photons. Now move to the sphere that is twice as far away and draw a square the same size. If you count the number of photons that pass through this square, you'll only count 1. Because of the inverse square law, the light spreads out. Each square on the sphere twice as far away receives only a quarter of the light as the square on the first sphere. A star's luminosity depends on apparent brightness and distance. In most cases, we can easily measure apparent brightness from Earth. The distance is often more difficult to determine, but we need it if we want to determine luminosity. We'll discuss distance measurements in just a bit. To describe apparent brightness and luminosity, we use what is called the magnitude system. It was developed by the Greek astronomer Hipparchus over 2,000 years ago. The magnitude system originally classified stars based on how bright they looked to human eyes. The brightest stars were called first magnitude, and the next brightest stars second magnitude, and so on. The faintest visible stars were magnitude 6. These descriptions are called apparent magnitudes because they compare how bright different stars appear in the sky. We denote apparent magnitudes with a lowercase m. The magnitude scale is such that a larger number for apparent magnitude means a dimmer apparent brightness. A star of apparent magnitude 4 appears dimmer in the sky than a star of apparent magnitude 1. Objects brighter than magnitude 0 go negative. For example, the full moon has an apparent magnitude of minus 13. The original magnitude scale was based on the human eye. Astronomers use a more precisely defined system today. The modern magnitude system also defines absolute magnitudes as a way of describing stellar luminosities. A star's absolute magnitude is the apparent magnitude it would have if it were at a distance of 10 parsecs from Earth. We denote absolute magnitudes with an uppercase M. For example, the sun's apparent magnitude, how bright it appears to us, is minus 27. If we were to move the sun 10 parsecs away, it would appear dimmer and we would measure an apparent magnitude of 4.8. Therefore, the absolute magnitude of the sun is 4.8. Remember, if we want to get at luminosity, we need to know distance. The most direct way to measure a star's distance is with stellar parallax. We'll discuss other methods of determining distance later in the semester. You may recall that parallax is the apparent shift in position of a nearby object against the background of more distant objects. Astronomers measure stellar parallax by comparing observations of a nearby star made 6 months apart. A nearby star will appear to shift against the background of more distant stars because we are observing it from two points of the Earth's orbit. We can calculate a star's distance if we know the precise amount of the star's annual shift due to parallax. This means we measure the angle P, which we call the star's parallax angle. Note that P is equal to half the star's annual back and forth shift. The farther the star is from us, the smaller the parallax angle becomes. More distant stars have smaller parallax angles. Even the nearest stars to us have parallax angles smaller than 1 arcsecond, well below the angular resolution of the human eye. This is why ancient Greeks were never able to measure parallax. By definition, the distance to an object with a parallax angle of 1 arcsecond is 1 parsec. If we use units of arcseconds for the parallax angle P, the distance in parsecs is simply 1 over the parallax angle. For example, for a star with a parallax angle of 1/2 of an arcsecond, the distance is 2 parsecs. Remember, if you know a star's distance, you can determine its luminosity. For a star you have measured the parallax angle for, you can calculate the distance, and then you can measure the apparent brightness. You have everything you need to determine luminosity, the intrinsic brightness of the star. That's all for now. We'll learn how astronomers measure stellar temperature and mass in the next lecture. Take care. I'll talk to you soon.